Okay, thank you, Cynthia. Welcome. Before we start, this nice picture I found here is from a Metropolitan Museum here in New York. So they just recently published like 350,000 pictures to the public domain. You can go and search through their entire catalog and download whatever you want. Okay, yeah, my name is Andreas. I'm actually from Germany, came over from Europe here. Part of Postgres Europe, we run conferences in Europe all over the country, or all over the continent. I work for a company called Pivotal, which is a spin-off from EMC, and we do Postgres and Greenplum data warehousing. Okay, do I have to tell you about Postgres? No, good. Yeah, as you mentioned, please shut off your WhatsApp. Okay, quick question. We're talking about data types. How many data types do we have in Postgres? Any idea? Come again? Good. Okay, when I looked into my database, I found 361. That's a lot, that's too many. Well, actually, we get one data type for every table we have. So we have table types as well. If you include any table type we have, then I end up as having 82. It's still a lot. And luckily, we have the nice documentation from Postgres. That's a long list of data types you will see in every Postgres database. It's Postgres 9.6. Bare install. All of them are there. How many of them do you know?
Less than I thought.
Yeah. Okay, in the documentation, we'll find this list. It's still 41 data types, which comes with every Postgres database. And we're going to talk about each and every one. No. I understand I'm between you and the afternoon party, so let's make it quick. Okay, how many data types in Postgres are you actually using? 2, 5, more? Give me some answers, please. 5, 10? 10 is a lot already. Anyone more than 10?
The IP number.
Yeah, well, how many different data types are you using in Postgres?
Something like 15 or 20.
That's the highest number I've heard in this talk. Okay, we look into some basic data types we have, starting with text and numeric, look into dates, JSON, XML, Boolean, and also into binary data and network data types, just for you. Let's start with text. How many text data types do we have? We have 3. So we have VARCHAR, we have CHAR, and we have text in Postgres. And internally, it's all the same. They don't differentiate here. Only option you have for VARCHAR and CHAR, you can actually specify a length, which is optional for both of them. For text, you cannot specify a length. Keep in mind, text data types in Postgres are text sensitive, case sensitive. So if you want to compare case insensitive, you have to use I like instead of like. If you come from other databases like MySQL, that's a problem because they compare case insensitive. Any text data type in Postgres can actually store up to roughly a gigabyte of data. If you specify a length for VARCHAR, it will store up to the length you specify, excluding any white space. That's a bit complicated, I'll show you in the next slide. If you do not specify a length for CHAR, it will be a 1-byte CHAR. So it's probably not what you want to use. You want to specify a length for CHAR here. And that's the difference between VARCHAR, CHAR, and text. It's all about white space handling in the end. Looks a bit complicated. Let me walk through this. So you see on the top we have 3 VARCHAR with lengths of 1, 5, and 10. And I always specify 5 white spaces here. And on the bottom you can see for VARCHAR, I always get my 5 white spaces, except I specified 1 as a length, so that's cut off. And for CHAR, I always get the length I specified here, so it's filled up with the length I have. I specified in the last line here, I specified CHAR10, I only have 5 white spaces, so it's filled up with another, sorry, it's filled up by Postgres with another 5 white spaces to make it a CHAR10. Okay, how does it handle internally? Postgres uses by default pages which are 8 kilobyte. Anything must fit into an 8 kilobyte page in Postgres. So how can I store 1 gigabyte of text in 8 kilobyte? Any ideas? Well, I can cut it short, I can compress it. Actually, what happens is I have rows. And for every row I have a page header and my row. And everything which has a variable length, like text, varchar, is not really stored in my table, but it's just a pointer to another table, which we call toast table here. So I have my 4-byte pointer to my toast table. It's all handled internally by Postgres. And in my toast table, I can have as many rows as I want, up to my 1 gigabyte of length. So if you run a vacuum on a Postgres database, occasionally you will see that it also does a vacuum on something called toast tables. If you actually look at the output of vacuum, that's where Postgres handles all the variable length data types here. And what about this CHAR255? Anyone here has a CHAR255 in their database? Why? What's the reason?
We have an access database, and it's limited to 255 characters, so we were trying to match that on a short text field.
Yeah. Access, or maybe coming from MySQL, it's the same problem. So I looked up how many projects are using CHAR255 or VARCHAR255. You can see it's roughly 500,000 hits here, I see, or roughly on search code, a bit more than 10,000 projects are using this internally. So it really doesn't apply to Postgres, so there's no length limit 255 in Postgres. If you find this in Postgres, there must be a very good reason, like compatibility with another database. Or maybe developer just doesn't know what they're doing. It might also be to do in Postgres, in MySQL, if you want to put an index on an index key, it can only have up to 767 bytes. So if you have an index column with 10,000 bytes, it will actually only use the 700 something bytes for the index. That's 3 times 255 for UTF. MySQL handles UTF always as 3 characters, as 3 bytes. That's their limit of 255 they have. Okay. By the way, any question you have, please just ask. Numeric data types. So we have integer data types, we have floating point data types, we have numeric and sequences. Let's have a look. So for numeric data types, we have small int using 2 bytes, integer using 4 bytes, and big integer using 8 bytes. I haven't really found a use case for small int so far. Maybe you have one. Keep in mind, if you have small int columns in a table and you mix small int and integer columns, you actually lose space on disk. So I have an example down here. Well, let's say you have small int, integer. You think it's 12 bytes. It's actually 16 bytes because Postgres will align it to 4 bytes. So after the first small int here, it will insert 2 bytes space which are not used. And after the second small int will also use not use 2 bytes because it needs to align the integer to 4 bytes. So if you just rearrange it to small int, you have 4 bytes here, that's fine. And then another 4 bytes for the integer here, it's 12 bytes. Yes, please?
On disk or memory?
On disk. Please louder. I don't get this question, sorry.
But reordering the columns after the table has been created resolves the alignment problem?
We'll reorder the columns solves the problem. You have to recreate the table. You cannot really reorder columns in Postgres. So you cannot really say, OK, order table, move column 1 to column 3. You have to do a create table as select from the old table into the new table, which is basically a new table with a new disk layout. Okay, double precision. We have real using 4 bytes, and we have double precision using 8 bytes. Keep in mind, even if Postgres shows you the exact number as output, it might be inaccurate internally. Just to give you some examples here, on the top I have 6 digits casted to real. In the moment I use 7 digits here, you see it starts rounding this number because it doesn't really fit into 4 bytes anymore. Or another example, I have 7 digits here in on the bottom, and it starts rounding my number to 1,000,002, even though I specified 1,000,001. It's always inaccurate. So if you want to store any kind of money, numeric data, whatsoever, please don't use floating points. Same example for double precision here. So as long as I use 15 digits internally, it seems to be fine. The moment I exceed my 15 digits, I go to 16, it starts rounding my output.
Output of presentation. Output or internal presentation.
Internally, it's already rounded. So it's always stored as an base and an exponent.
Always.
Yes, it's always. Yes. Even though your output seems to look correct, it might be already changed internally. So, if you have something, some inaccurate numbers like coming in data from your network monitoring or such, it's okay, you can use floating point numbers. If you do any kind of monetary values, please don't use floating point numbers. Okay, we have a money data type in Postgres. Please don't use this as well. There are like 2 users in the world using money data type. It was called dead 2 or 3 times already, resurrected, because we have, well, 2 users. It can store a huge amount of money, actually, so it's a numeric data type internally. And you see it can handle up to 92, what is it, quadrillion here. So whatever you have as a debt here in the US, it's like 19 trillion last I checked. It still fits into a money data type, but don't bet on it. One of the problems you have with money is it always comes with a currency as a representation. So whatever you specify as LC monetary here, might it be euro, dollar, whatever, it's always in your output. You have to deal with it. And you cannot really transform between different currencies here. So, if you want to store money, we have to use numeric. And numeric has a precision up to 1,000 digits. If you ever have a use case where you have to store more than 1,000 digits, please let me know. I haven't found one so far. The way you use it is you specify the total number of digits you have, like 10 here, and the number of digits after your decimal point. So I have 7 digits before my decimal point, and 3 digits afterwards, so it's total 10, and then 3. One of the downsides is it's really handled in software, so there's no hardware support. Unlike an integer, which you just load into a CPU register, it can be processed very fast. Numeric is handled in software, so it will be a bit slower. Anyone knows this guy? Anyone playing chess? Anyone knows this guy? We heard about the story? Okay, yeah, so they started putting 1 rice grain on a first chess board and then just doubled the number all the time. So about how much wires are we talking here? Any idea? Be careful. So we are talking about 2 to the power of 64 minus 1. And if we use double precision here, you see it already starts becoming very inaccurate here. But if we use numeric, where's the 2 numeric to the power of 64 numeric minus 1, you see it's using like 20 digits here, and we have still 980 left in numeric. Anytime you need to have precise numbers, you must use numeric. Whereas the other exception is, like if you do money, you can just use pennies instead of dollars and store everything into a big int, as long as it fits into a big int. But then you have to do all the calculations from pennies into dollars and vice versa. Yeah, it's a bit slower. Okay, then we have sequences. A sequence is basically what you know as auto-increment from other databases. You specify your data type as a serial and not as an integer, and Postgres will always increase this number every time you insert something. By default, sequences start by 1 and increase by 1 in the positive direction, and they will not cycle. It means if a sequence comes to an end, it will just stop and generate an error when you ask for the next value. But you can change all of this. You can have a sequence going backwards. You can have a sequence cycling around. You can have a sequence going 5 steps forwards at a time. All of this works. And one exception, sequences are not transactional. Whatever value you ask from a sequence will not give them back if you roll back a transaction. So if you insert like 1,000 rows into a table with a sequence, you generate or you consume 1,000 sequence values, you roll back, the sequence values are gone. The next one will use 1,001. So you can ask for the current value of a sequence by using a curveball, but it only works if you, in your current session, already inserted something. So you cannot ask for the value which was inserted by another session. It always has to be your session. You can generate with next wall, or you can fetch the next value of a sequence, and then you can go and ask the same value again using curveball. You can also set a sequence to a new value using setWall. And some people like to have not so many big gaps in sequences if they roll back big transactions. So you can just go and set a sequence to the maximum value you have in your table right now. That's easy to do. Okay, there's one function you should keep in mind. It's pgget_sequence. By default, sequence name always looks like that's my table name, that's my column name, and that's a prefix Postgres adds here. But don't really bet on it. If you use pgget_sequence, it will always tell you the name of the sequence attached to this column. It's very good for automation if you just want to find out the sequence name for a specific table. A sequence is really just another table in Postgres, so you can select from a sequence. If you do this, you get a number of columns, so it's my sequence name, it's the last name, last value I used. I see all the default settings I have here, so it's incrementing by 1. Max value shows me it's really a big int sequence, and so on. Going from text to date and times. What is this? Any idea? South Pole? Any other options? I agree. So we have 90 degrees south here latitude on a bottom left, which gives it away. What time is it at South Pole right now? Well, if you use Postgres, it can answer it. Okay, date and time types. So we have timestamp with and without time zone, which obviously stores a date and a time. If you have a timestamp without time zone, it will just store the date and the time, no matter which time zone you are right now. If you store a time zone as well, it will always calculate the value back to UTC and store the UTC value. We'll see in a moment why. Same is true for time. Date only stores a date without any time zone, obviously. And the interval is the difference between two times. I'll show you a few examples in a moment. Postgres will deal with any kind of daylight saving time if you specify a correct time zone. It will not deal with leap seconds. So it knows about leap days, but not leap seconds because they are not in a time zone database. Few examples here on the top. I specify an ISO date here, 2016, 10, 11, and cast it to a timestamp, and I get back same date, midnight. It really makes this date, or which what looks like a date, make it a timestamp, and I get midnight back. It also can handle date formats if you specify month names, like here, American format, month, first, day, year. You see it recognizes this format and returns 2017, 5th of January here. You can specify time zones as part of your timestamp. Here I specify UTC, 325 UTC, and it changed my output to 525. What happened? It also changed my time zone to +2. So my database server here is set to Central European time, which is +2 in summer. And my output, if I don't specify it otherwise, it's always in the time zone where my database server is running. So no matter which time or which time zone I specify, output always my time zone. You see I have 2 hours time difference here because it's August, and we have 2 hours summer time difference. Same, the other example here, it's a timestamp in December. Again, it's UTC, and I only get 1 hour time difference to UTC because we have winter time. You can also specify time zone names. This example here, it's Europe, Moscow. And if I specify a time zone name, not only a number, Postgres knows about all the daylight saving times, like Russia moved to summertime and didn't move back to winter time and so on. If you just specify a number here, obviously it cannot know about any daylight saving time. It just adds 4 hours. That's it. So how can I change my output? In this example here, I start a transaction because time stops inside of a transaction in Postgres. You see I have my timestamp here, 1:55:57. I temporarily set a new time zone to Europe Moscow and do a select now again. You see it changed to 3:55. So it did the transformation for me into my new time zone, which I specified. That's neat. It's a bit complicated because I have to change my time zone all the time. We can do better. You can also say, select now at a specific time zone. One moment. In this case, only this now is transformed into the new time zone I specify. Everything else, even the same query, it's using my other time zone where my database server is running in. Yes, please?
Can you change the time zone per connection base?
Yes, you can actually specify that time zone on a per connection basis. Okay. I can also do calculations between timestamps. Up here I have 5th of January 2000 minus 1st of January 2000. You see I get 4 days difference. That's an interval. Down here I just switched around dates and I get -3 days difference as an interval. I can not only use dates, I can also use timestamps with times in it. Or I get 10 days difference, 17 hours, and so on. So Postgres does other calculation for me if I use timestamps.
Can you round interval, say, down to the days?
Come again?
Like, let's say you only want the interval in days, or you want the interval in hours. Or something.
Yeah, then you, if you want to, the interval just in days, then you should not specify timestamp, but date. So like here, well, here I use timestamp, but it's already midnight because I haven't have any time specified here, so it's just producing days. If you cast it to days, it will just return days. Okay, what do we have here? 2028th of February, I add an interval here of 1 day and 2 hours, and I get back 29th of February, so obviously it's a leap year. Anyone questioning that 2000 is a leap year? I've seen this before. Or the other way around, 1st of January 2001 minus 1st of January 2000 returns 366 days. 2000 is a leap year. Yeah, now I have dates here and just returns the day number.
So what would be database tag of subtraction of two data
types? It's an interval.
Both intervals?
Yes. Well, the result is always an interval. If you do any kind of date, timestamp, addition, multiplicar, whatever, it's always an interval result. And down here, next year, 2002 minus 2001, I get 365, it's no leap year. Okay, back to my initial question. What time is it at South Pole? South Pole is running Scott Amundsen Station. It belongs to the United States, but it's supplied from New Zealand. And for easiness, they just use a New Zealand time zone down there at South Pole. So if you want to know what time is it at South Pole, we can just use a New Zealand time zone. Select now at time zone New Zealand. Well, that's a bit cheating because it's really New Zealand, it's not Antarctica, right? Your operating system knows about Antarctica as well. You can really ask for what time is it at South Pole right now. Your time zone database knows about it. Okay, let's move on. Anyone still using XML? 2, 3, 4? Wow. Was really hip back in the 90s, before we had JSON. Postgres can store any kind of XML data type and XML fractions of data types. It's a bit complicated for encoding handling. Anytime you don't specify a client encoding, it will just assume it's UTF-8. Except when it's binary, then it's not. So here we have a full document. So we specify XML path as a document here and specify our entire XML document as string. And it's transformed into an XML type internally and stored. It's also validated. That means it will actually verify if I have opening and closing text and everything, but it will not validate a DDT. I can do the same for just a bit of XML here. So you see it returns XML type here as an output. What you can't do in Postgres, you cannot really search in it. So you can store it, you can retrieve it, but not search in it. Well, you can do it by transforming it back to text and do a like or such, but you cannot really have Postgres just looking for one specific text in a tree. This doesn't work. Okay, how many of you are using JSON? One moment. JSON? That's a bit more. Yes, please?
What's the benefit of using XML? If you can't search or
do anything, then... Well, it was really heavily used back in the 90s and 2000s before JSON came around. So we had it because everyone was using it. And you can actually make sure that whatever you store in Postgres as a XML type is valid. So opening, closing text, everything is there. That's for sure.
You can XPath into it and return fields. And you can build an index on that, so you can predictively search.
Have fun. Yeah. So these days, almost everyone is using JSON. So we have JSON in two implementations, actually. So we have old format, which is called JSON itself. It stores the raw data. And every time you access this raw data as a JSON type, it needs to do the parsing. So it's overhead. And then the Russians came around and created JSONB, which will do all the parsing the moment you store it, the JSON, in your database. And then you can do all fancy stuff like searching in it and selecting just parts of your JSON and so on. You can put an index on it. You can drink vodka. And all of this works inside of regular transactions in Postgres. So unlike other JSON databases, we know where things can go wrong or just vanish because two different connections update the same value. In Postgres, it's all handled in transactions. And it's actually faster. So here we create a JSONB data type. You see I have double quotes. So my single quotes here are for Postgres. And everything inside my single quotes are for JSON, and I need to quote my JSON text as well. That's why I have double quotes here. I can create arrays in JSON. You see again, I have my single quotes here at the beginning and end, and everything inside all the text here are quoted with double quotes, and I get back my array as a JSON array or as a dictionary with key value pairs. All of this works. And now the nice thing, I can actually look into my key value pairs. In this case, I just want to have this value which is key 2. It just returns this single part here. Or I can find out if the right value is in my array in a left value. So I don't have to extract all my data, all my JSON data from my database and find out if a specific value is in my database. I can have Postgres doing this for me. Same here, is this key in my key list here? So 2 is actually key in my dictionary here, so it returns 2 for me. One of the problems you have with NoSQL databases and NoSQL applications, they have no schema. So occasionally you run into applications which expanded their schema because in the end they have a schema, but older versions of a data row might not have any row or any column in your data like newer versions. So you need to find out if specific columns are actually in your data or not. That's one way to do it. And then of course you can put, or you can create an index on top of any JSONB value by using a JIN index on top of it. Got it? This example here, where I create a JIN index on my table, and I have to specify which field should go into my index. And then when I use the same field, JSON field, in my query as a where condition, then it will use an index. Okay, Boolean. If you ever have a need to store any kind of Boolean values, please don't use a small int or char or whatever. Please really use a Boolean value in Postgres. Well, I see people coming from databases like MySQL, where there's no real Boolean value. They start using small int, 0 and 1, and over time it's 2, 5, 7. What is 7 in a Boolean? Please?
It's more true.
7 is more true than 1. That's cool.
7 is minus 1.
Okay. So we have different input values for Boolean value in Postgres, like 2 uppercase, lowercase, T, Y, yes, and so on. You can use all of them. In the end, you will always get back a T or an F for true or false. It's just more convenient to use whatever input value you have here. So it looks like this. 2 casted to Boolean returns me a T, and F returns me an F here. A false returns me an F. Really convenient to do. And you can put an index on it, just to give you a use case. I have a table, let's say large log table, millions of entries. Occasionally, there's an error. So what happens if you put an index on this error column to find out all the rows with an error in it? You end up with having 98, 99% of rows in your index which are never ever used for a query. Or I can use a conditional index in Postgres. Here I just create me a table and insert a million rows and use a random statement. So 2% of the rows should be error 2, everything else should be error false. Let's look into it. If I use an select count from this table and want to see how many rows are error 2, you see I have a sequential scan here. And now I create an index on top of it where error is 2. So all it does, it only stores the rows where this error flag or this error boolean is actually set to 2. Everything else where it's false, it's ignored because I don't care about the 98% here. And now it really starts using an index-only scan if you have this where condition error is true. And to look at sizes, so I create another index, full index on this column as well. This table has about 6,300 pages on disk. My full index has 2,700 pages on disk, and my partial index only has 57 pages on disk. So that's 2,690 pages for the full index, which I will never ever use, because that's the other 98%. Makes things so much faster. Okay, anyone using bit types? For what? What's your use case? Bitmap in or bits?
Maybe it's bitmap.
Okay, we can store bits in Postgres as well. We have a bit data type with a fixed length or variable length. You can specify how many bits you want to store, and then you can do all the fancy bit operations on it, like AND or exclusive OR and so on. Where you do it, specify a column using bit data type, specify a length here. And then I can make Postgres inserting bits value into my table, so I don't have to do all the calculation back from my decimal values or from my binary values back to decimal. Let's just Postgres do it. Where's my pointer here? So you see I just put a B in front of my bit information here, and Postgres transforms it into bits. And if I select from my table, I have 10101. Let's keep this in mind. Question? No. Come again? Yes, I could store several flags in it. However, every flag cost me 1 byte. Even though I only use 1 bit, it will cost me 1 byte. I can only have 1,500 columns in a table. Using bits, it's a bit more efficient. So at the top here, I do an AND operation on my bits. So I have my data column, and I only want to see all the bits where both bits in my data and my search value are set, and I see it's only the second and the fourth bit which is set. No, actually, that's an XOR. Here's my AND, sorry. I only want to see bits where the last bit on the right is set. And this is set in my input value because I have 10101. And it's set in my search value, which is only the white bit. So I get back all bits deleted except the one on the white. And the same for OR. I just flip around all my bits here and I get back 11111 because at any time one of these bits is set. XOR basically flips around the value any time where one is set. So I end up with 01010. And of course, I can also shift to the left, which is a multiplication. So my original value was 21. If I shift everything by one byte to the one, to the left, I just multiply by 2, and I end up with 42 as a result. I can also search in my bits. So here, I just want to search for this bit, and I get back my data value here because the white bit is set. In the bottom example here, I shift this bit. I want to find any value where the second bit from the white is set, and obviously I don't have data value, so I don't get back anything. As I mentioned before, I can have Postgres doing all the bit calculation for me, which is very nice and convenient. So my integer 23 here, I can cast to a bit, and I end up with a bit value. Or a bit more to the extreme, I start with a bit value here. I cast it to my bit, and I cast it to integer. I get my 21. Or I can do the same with hex values as well. I start with x, as fe, which is 1 before 255. But specify to Postgres, okay, this is really a hex value and not a not a numeric value, and Postgres does also transformation for me. I don't have to do this manually. Okay. Anyone storing binary data in Postgres? Why?
Files. Big binary files.
Oh, why?
Actually, we seldom do it, but we have done this.
So you moved away from it. You learned your lesson. Hmm? You learned your lesson.
Yes, well, it's sometimes, not anymore, but
yeah.
We used to do it, yeah.
Well, if you want to do it, there's a byte A data type in Postgres, which stores binary data. And the problem, if you want to store binary data in a database, occasionally there's a byte in your data stream where all bits are deleted, 0. Unfortunately, Postgres is written in C, and a byte where all bits are deleted means end of string. If you send a query string to the database where one of these bytes appears, well, for Postgres, it means, okay, here your query string ends and you end up in a syntax error. You can't really do it this way. The way we do it in Postgres is, the way you want to store data in Postgres is by using whatever your programming language gives you. If it's Java, if it's Python, whatsoever, they all have functions to deal with binary data. Please don't write your own wrapper. Use whatever is there, it works. I've seen people doing their own stuff, like escaping all the data for Postgres back and forth. Don't. You end up with more problems. The output in Postgres can have two different ways. On top, it's the new output we have. It's called hex. You switch it by byte A output to hex, which is the default by now. And you get every byte escaped as a hex value. And the old output in the bottom is escape format, where only the problematic characters were escaped by using a backslash and 1, 2, 3 numbers, which is a bit problematic because you have to pass how many numbers are coming after your backslash. That's why they switch to hex, and you always have 2 digits. But then again, programming language takes care of this problem, does other transformation for you. Network type. So we can store all kind of fancy network information in Postgres. We have an INET type and CIDR type, which can store network masks, and one type for MAC addresses, which is very good to store any kind of log file information in Postgres. And please don't use char for this. So on the top, I store a network here. So it's 1.9.168.0.1/24, which is 256 IP addresses. You see it stores this entire type in my INET here. Here in the middle, I just specify an IP address, and Postgres will go and assume a network mask for me. In this case, it's a /32, one single IP address. Here I only specify parts of an IP address, and Postgres again assumes a network address, and it's an old class C network /24. And the beauty of it, you can put an index on it. You can really speed up your queries. So I have a demo table here. I insert some IP addresses here, and I create an index on it. So I have two addresses with 1.2.168 and one with 10. And in my query here, I want to find any IP address which is in this /24 range. And you see it returns these two IP addresses, and it leaves out the 10 dot IP address, all supported by an index. Fast. Here's your index scan. Okay, last but not least, we can create our own data types in Postgres. Yes, please? Yes, it is. IPv6 is supported as well. It works with both IPv4 and IPv6. You can have composite types in Postgres, you can have range types, enumerations, and you can really write your own data types in Postgres if there's a need to. We will not go into this detail here. What we have in Postgres is enumerations. It's basically a list of values. Other people use a 1-to-n table for it. You can take a shortcut and just create an enum for it. Keep in mind, for an enum, this list should not change. Well, in the end, it can, but it should not. Question: how many gender types do you know? How many? Four. Any more? Five. Well, our lovely Facebook knows 56. There's a whole ISO standard just dealing with this problem. If you want to handle gender in an enum, be prepared to extend your enum, and again, and again. Anyone knows this card game? Well, that's a perfect example for an enum, because these four values never change. Create an enum out of it. Oh, it's diamonds, hearts, spades, and clubs. And then you can use this data type here like any other data type in Postgres. Makes life easy. So I can insert any of these values from my enum here into my table. If I select from my table, Postgres does as a lookup for me and replaces the numbers it's using internally with my values from my enum. I can even use all of these values in my search, where I can search for everything which is hearts. I can put an index on it. Things are fast. Okay, what's missing? That's the next talk, next year, please come back. So we have areas in Postgres which are not covered here. So we have composite types and range types. We have a whole range of geometric types, if you think about PostGIS. We have UUID types, OIDs, and so on. And as I mentioned before, you can really create your own data types. But it's probably yet another talk, just how we create data types. So, any questions? I know a party is coming up. Yes, please.
So JSON has JSON and JSONB.
Yes.
What is XML do? Is that a binary representation like
JSONB? XML is a whole different data type. It's it has nothing to do with JSON or JSONB.
Sorry, JSON stores that as a string.
JSON stores it as raw data,
right.
And JSONB parses it.
Right.
Yeah.
So does XML
parses it? Yes. So JSONB is like XML, just more functionality. Yes, please.
You can have indexes on JSONB columns, right?
We can have indexes on JSONB columns, yes, you have to specify what exactly you're looking for in your JSON data.
How do they perform?
Very well. So we actually have customers moving from MongoDB to Postgres because JSONB is faster in Postgres than MongoDB can do. Any other question? Oh, two more. Yes, please. I'm a bit more, realistic. If I know I have to change an enum, I'm going to use a table anyway.
For all cases in which you'd have to change it?
Yes. Enum is really when you don't expect to change your value. Ever.
Ever.
Yeah. I mean, you can do it, but then you have to alter your database all the time, because changing an enum is a DDL statement, and altering your table is just a DML statement. Yes, please.
What's the speed difference to, between like storing a network type and like storing it as a VARCHAR?
Well, first of all, you can put an index on your network type. So any kind of operation you have, it will be faster than storing it in a char. If you just want to store something without ever searching in it, char is probably faster. But if you want to do any kind of operation like, is this IP address is in this network, or I'm just looking for this specific range, enet will be faster. Okay, thank you.